Avascular necrosis of the femoral head, AVN. The hip is a ball and socket joint. The socket is formed by the acetabulum, which is part of the large pelvis bone. The ball is the femoral head. The surface of the ball and socket is covered with articular cartilage, a smooth, slippery substance that protects the bones and enables them to glide easily across each other. Osteonecrosis of the hip occurs in the femoral head. It is a painful condition that occurs when the blood supply to the head of the femur is disrupted. This typically leads to death of the bone cells in a localized area of the femoral head, leading to collapse of the necrotic segment of the head. As a result, the articular cartilage covering the hip bones also collapses, leading to disabling arthritis within a few months to 2 years. Anyone can be affected, but the condition is most common in people between the ages of 30 and 50. In 80% of cases, both hips are affected by the disease. Causes. In most cases, the cause of this loss of blood supply is unknown or termed idiopathic. Genetics likely play a role. Hip dislocations and certain types of hip fracture can damage the blood supply to the femoral head. There are, however, a number of risk factors that make it more likely for someone to develop this condition. Overconsumption of alcohol over time can cause fatty deposits to form in the blood vessels, resulting in a decreased blood supply to the bone. Long-term use of systemic cortisone carries a higher risk of developing AVN. Cancer treatments involving radiation also can weaken bone and harm blood vessels. Blood disorders like thalassemia and sickle cell disease can cause small clots to form in the tiny arteries supplying blood to the femoral head, thereby blocking blood flow to part of the bone. An unusual condition called Caisson's disease, seen in deep-sea divers, it causes the release of nitrogen bubbles into the arterial circulation, which can block the blood vessels of the femoral head. Osteonecrosis has been reported to occur in approximately 5 to 20% of renal transplantation patients. Medical conditions, such as Gaucher's disease, systemic lupus erythematosus, Crohn's disease, vasculitis, human immunodeficiency virus, hypercoagulable states, and autoimmune disorders. There are two types of osteonecrosis are limited to children. Idiopathic osteonecrosis of the femoral head, Perthes disease, and osteonecrosis occurring in children, usually adolescents, with a slipped capital femoral epiphysis. These diseases were discussed in detail separately. Symptoms. Osteonecrosis of the hip develops in stages, and early on there are often no symptoms, with the condition only being picked up incidentally on a scan or other radiological investigation. As the condition progresses and there are bone changes, most patients will experience pain, which is usually felt in the groin area but may radiate into the thigh or very occasionally into the buttock. Pain can be mild, it usually develops gradually. Then it usually starts becoming more severe, affecting all weight-bearing activities but also occurring with leg movements and bending. Eventually the hip is often painful at rest, movement is restricted and activity is severely limited. Diagnosis. It is very important that avascular necrosis is diagnosed early in the disease process, as the success of the treatment relates to the stage at which the treatment starts. After discussing your symptoms and medical history, your doctor will examine your hip to discover which specific motions cause your pain. On examination, there is usually a painful range of motion, particularly with forced internal rotation and abduction. The other hip must also be evaluated. Imaging studies will help your doctor confirm the diagnosis. The earliest findings are mild density changes, followed by sclerosis and cysts as the disease progresses. On X-ray, a thin, curvilinear lucent line parallel to the cortical margin of the femoral head, in a patient with AVN, It is the crescent sign, an evidence of subchondral collapse. Later stages reveal loss of sphericity or collapse of the femoral head. Ultimately, joint space narrowing and degenerative changes in the acetabulum are visible. MRI of the affected joint should be performed if radiographs are negative and the medical history supports a suspicion of osteonecrosis. MRI has the capability to pick up very early stage osteonecrosis before symptoms have started, and is useful for determining how much bone is involved by the condition. It is also extremely useful for evaluating the opposite hip for this condition, as osteonecrosis can develop in both hips, particularly in those individuals where a systemic or general risk factor is present, which are discussed previously. Classification systems based largely on radiographic findings have been developed to provide information on the extent of disease and risk of progression, and thus, help guide treatment decisions. The condition is classified into Stage 1. Normal radiograph, abnormal MRI findings. Stage 2. No crescent sign, radiographic evidence of sclerosis, osteolysis or focal osteoporosis. Stage 3. Subchondral fracture, fracture in the necrotic portion and or flattening of the femoral head on radiograph. Stage 3A. Femoral head depression is less than or equal to 2 mm. Stage 3B. Femoral head depression greater than 2 mm. Stage 4. Evidence of osteoarthritis, joint space narrowing, degenerative acetabular change. Treatment. The treatment of avascular necrosis depends on the size of the lesion, its location, age of the patient, symptoms, and most importantly the stage of the condition. For patients with no evidence of femoral head collapse, management approach is largely guided by the volume of bone affected and the likelihood of progression to collapse. For patients with a small lesion involving less than 15% of the femoral head, we suggest non-surgical treatment rather than surgery. Non-surgical treatment consists of offloading as tolerated, using assistive walking devices including crutches, canes, and walkers, physical therapy, and the use of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, NSAIDs. Patients who do not undergo surgery are followed periodically for clinical evaluation of pain and range of motion. Routine follow-up of patients with osteonecrosis does not typically require serial MRI. Radiographs can generally be used to evaluate the contour of the femoral head. Therapies and interventions that have been used but are not proven include bisphosphonates, cholesterol-lowering drugs, anticoagulation, vasodilators, extracorporeal shockwave therapy, ESWT, electromagnetic stimulation, and hyperbaric oxygen. For patients with medium lesions involving 15 to 30% of the femoral head, we suggest core decompression, with or without grafting, or bone grafting rather than supportive therapy. This procedure is only relevant when osteonecrosis is diagnosed in its very early stages, often before symptoms and certainly before changes are seen on plain X-ray. Core decompression is a procedure that involves the drilling of one large or several small holes into the affected area of the femoral head, to relieve pressure within the bone and to create channels for new blood vessels to grow into the avascular bone. Sometimes bone grafting is undertaken in addition to decompressive surgery. Sometimes, bone marrow cells may be mixed together with the graft substitute to help in the bone regeneration process. Another surgical option is a vascularized or free fibula graft. In this procedure, a segment of bone is taken from the small bone in your leg, the fibula, along with its blood supply, an artery and vein, for vascularized graft. This graft is transplanted into a hole created in the femoral neck and head, and the artery and vein are reattached to help heal the area of osteonecrosis. Both of non-vascularized and vascularized bone grafts provide structural support and act as a scaffold onto which new bone can form. Vascularized bone grafting also improves perfusion to ischemic bone. Bone grafting in this manner is predominantly used to treat symptomatic patients with minimal collapse of the femoral head. Large-sized lesions involving greater than 30% of the femoral head that are pre-collapse, we suggest not using a core decompression in grafting, because 85% of patients with large lesions fail these procedures, and they are highly likely to progress to collapse and may need to undergo total hip arthroplasty. This approach avoids subjecting the patient to a procedure that is not likely to benefit the patient. For symptomatic early lesions with less than 2 mm of depression, we suggest vascularized or non-vascularized bone grafting, as I've already said. These techniques may delay progression and reduce the need for future hip arthroplasty in some, but not all, patients. Rotational osteotomy can be used in younger patients for patients with a small lesion, less than 15%, and with minimal collapse. The goal is to redistribute the weight-bearing forces away from the area of necrosis. This procedure includes intertrochanteric rotational osteotomy to shift the affected areas of the femoral head away from the weight-bearing zones of the hip. The application of this procedure is limited because it is technically demanding and because due to the subsequent difficulty converting osteotomies to total hip arthroplasty when needed. If osteonecrosis has advanced to the point where the femoral head has already collapsed, the most successful treatment is total hip replacement. In this procedure, your doctor removes the damaged bone and cartilage, then positions new metal or plastic joint surfaces to restore the function of your hip. Physical therapy after surgery is also a key component for recovery. It starts immediately the day after surgery. It takes a few months for the bone to heal. During this time, you will need to use a walker or crutches to avoid putting stress on the damaged bone.